much. So it's nice to be here at WSN with all of you lovely people to hear about some new ideas and some new research and to be in the room with a bunch of smart people. Most of you are probably smarter than me in that you didn't bring your one-year-old baby to the meeting today. So if you hear some squawking in the back, that might be my fault. So good afternoon. My name's Claire Steele. I'm here from Cal State University Channel Islands. And actually two of my co-authors are here as well, Sean Anderson and Dorothy Horn. And I wanted to tell you a little bit today about some work that we're doing in an emerging field looking at microplastic debris. I just came from a two-day meeting looking at policy, California state policy on ocean litter. And this was one of the big topics that was brought up. So I'm happy to talk to you about microplastics or marine debris or state policy on those types of things. So just briefly, most of you know that marine debris accumulates in the world's oceans, particularly in those areas of circulation, the gyres, and rather than being an island of floating trash, that what we have is sort of this plastic soup. And one of the major problems with marine debris, and particularly plastics, which are the predominant component of marine debris, is that they don't degrade, they don't biodegrade, right? They don't break down, they break up. And so they break up into smaller and smaller pieces. Sorry, I wander away from the microphone. And so we have this problem in the oceans and in coastal environments. We're particularly interested in sandy beach environments. We have this problem of very small particles of mostly plastic debris floating around. And that comes with a whole host of problems, risks to wildlife, of entanglement, of ingestion, so that their guts become occluded and you have a problem with not actually getting nutrition. That seems to be a huge problem for seabirds feeding their young these plastic particles. And one of the properties of plastic debris in the ocean is that it has this propensity to attract organic pollutants. So these persistent organic pollutants, nasty things like DDT, are attracted to the surfaces of plastic, and so not only are plastics themselves problematic because of the additives that we put on them or in them, there's also the issue of these adsorbed chemicals that are then, you know, using the plastics as a vehicle to be ingested by organisms. And then there's the economic cost. In California, beaches are a huge driver of recreational and tourism industry. Municipalities have to spend a lot of money and effort cleaning up beaches, cleaning up coastal environments. We just talked a lot at this other meeting that I was at about different potential solutions for that. But it has many effects in the ecosystem. So we are working at all different scales with the macro trash, but I'm only going to talk really today about microplastics. So we're talking about sub 5 millimeter particles and down to sort of, you know, microscopic and then onto nanoscale particles. So it's accumulating in these coastal environments. We've been working all around the world with sand and sediments from coastal environments. Just these 15 countries that we've sampled in, we found that microplastics are present in every environment, that we've looked even in some very remote places that we've been in the South Pacific. In California, we see a lot of these fibers, synthetic fibers that are probably associated with, you know, the effluent from washing machines and municipal sources. So synthetic fibers. In other places like Hawaii, we tend to see a lot more particles of degraded plastics that were larger pieces. So unfortunately, I did a little bit of work to look at whether if we could, you know, look at the visually obvious plastics on beaches, whether that would predict the presence of microplastics. It doesn't seem to. I think just the way that the forces are causing things to accumulate on beaches is a little bit different from microplastics. But there you go. But suffice it to say that the great majority of these types of litters that we're seeing in the environment are plastic. There's a, you know, some non-plastic items, but predominantly plastic. So we're currently involved in a project to do some removals of debris from the Channel Islands in the Channel Islands National Park. We're working on two of the larger islands, Santa Rosa and Santa Cruz Island. And we also have a couple of mainland sites to do some comparisons there. But in all, we have 9 beaches. And just a little comparison, this is work that my other co-author, who's not here, Michaela Miller, is working on with us. Is the types of debris that we see on the Channel Islands. So these are islands where people don't live permanently. They're remote from the California mainland. So they have a different story behind them. But the majority of the types of macro debris that we're seeing are plastic debris. You'll notice on the Santa Rosa, this is red data from Santa Rosa Island, this big component of fishing gear. So this is part of the project that we're involved in to remove fishing gear, and particularly lobster traps and other sort of buoys and ropes and fishing associated debris, which is quite problematic. You know, when you're getting to these really remote sites, you're having to hike out with enormous quantities of litter and these large lobster traps on your back. So I won't spend too much time on the methodology of this. We are working on, the field is sort of working on consensus on how to best quantify microplastics, but basically it's a density separation using hypersaline solutions to separate plastics from the sediment. Now, I should just give you the caveat that not all plastics float. So that's one reason that we use a hypersaline solution to try and float as much plastic material as we can, but we're being quite conservative in the types of plastics that we are able to get at using these methods. So the problem may actually be more extensive given the fact that not all plastics are floating, and so we're basically quantifying particles right now by color and by type, things that are obviously synthetic and man-made. There are new techniques that we have trialed, and we're working on some new techniques to actually identify individual microscopic particles and fibers down to polymer type. So that's part of a new effort to sort of characterize debris the same way that we look at trash on beaches and, how many percent of that is cigarette butts and how many percent is chip wrappers and those kind of things. So looking at the distribution of microplastics on the beaches in California, so we have from Avalon in the north all the way down to Orange County, we sampled about 50 beaches, and then on the far right-hand side are the Channel Island beaches. I do have the thing here. So we are working within several littoral cells, so each of these are relatively self-contained compartments where the sediment is moving through. So we're working, this is sort of the first compartment, then the Santa Barbara Ventura compartment, the Zuma, Santa Monica. So within these compartments, we might expect to see some differences that sand is coming from the watershed and entering these coastal environments and being transported. So we might expect to see, and I've just highlighted these different compartments here. So if we look at the prevalence of microplastics across the Southern California Bight, essentially, we find plastics in every place that we look. Almost every single beach that we look at, we're finding these microplastics. And the great majority of them are fibers, so about 97% of what we're finding are these synthetic fibers. Some of them are particles, particularly, we started out looking for microbeads, but these are generally sort of degraded plastic particles. There's a significant difference between the littoral cells, between the sediment compartments, and there's a significant difference in the types of debris between the Channel Islands and the mainland. And some of that is the fact that there's more particles out on the Channel Islands, more of this degraded, probably marine source plastic, given that it's not local source. But there's a significant difference in how much plastic accumulation there is on those on the islands. So this is some of the work that Dorothy Horn has been working on and is continuing in her graduate studies. Microplastics are primary plastics, sort of nurdles and microbeads, and then secondary plastics like the fibers and fragments that are breakdown products, are likely to be ingested. They're of the sort of plankton size that filter feeders are going to be ingesting. So we have things like sand crabs that are, filter feeding and picking up these particles. It just so happens these are some grunion eggs here, look very, very much like the little microbeads that were that are from sort of personal care products. So they're of the appropriate size to be ingested, and then potentially, being passed up the food chain into, consumers of those filter feeders. So we're seeing them, these microfibers, and in some cases particles here, in the tissues of sand crabs, so we know that they're ingesting them. Dorothy found of 38 beaches, she collected sand crabs from all those beaches, about 35% of the sand crabs that occupy those beaches are have evidence of ingested microplastics, so we know that it's a very prevalent problem. And now we're looking into trophic transfer of microplastic to see how these are being passed up the food chain into consumers of things like sand crabs, like the barred surf perch. This has revealed another problem to me. I've been doing trash pickups on beaches, finding a lot of fishing, sort of recreational fishing lures and things like that. Again, these are residing in the marine environment, attracting these persistent organic pollutants, and then fish are eating them because they look, you know, they're designed to look like polychaetes and they're eating them. And then we're also seeing microplastics in the guts of fishes that we're looking at. So certainly there's the potential then for the trophic transfer. That's one area that we're continuing to investigate, the trophic transfer of these pollutants, of the plastics themselves, and then the microplastics, and then the adsorbed chemicals that that are associated with them. So I'm just checking my time here. Yeah, and one of the problems is that these plastics are so good at concentrating chemicals, they can concentrate persistent organic pollutants up to a million times the concentration in seawater, and then those are ingested. And we already know that there's tissue transfer of those types of pollutants. We also are starting to see more and more evidence of migration of those plastics from the gut into other tissues of the animal. There's a recent study that was looking at particles that had moved into the brains of fishes. So we know that they're not only sort of residing in the gut and potentially transferring chemicals, but also maybe moving around the tissues of these animals as they become these sort of nanoscale particles. So it's an emerging global issue. I'll be happy to talk more with you about it. It's a very exciting field that really we're just starting to understand the scale of this problem and to really pin down one of the ecological effects of this. We're seeing it in the human food chain, in fishes that people eat, in shellfish that people are consuming. So we're working on identifying potential sources of these plastics by identifying polymer type and potential sources of those. We're looking to further examine the biological impacts to see what are the toxicological effects. Dorothy and I have been working on looking at sublethal effects of these microplastic ingestions, to see if they affect the reproductive capacity of organisms or if they affect the behavior of organisms. And then to see this ingestion of multiple trophic levels to see how these plastics are potentially moving through the system. And that's right on time because my email address is here. I'd be glad to talk to any more of you, and I'll be here moderating the rest of the session for today. So I think I have about 30 seconds if anyone has a quick question. Otherwise, I can talk.